này. Đây là phim hình mi. I try to show you guys here, baby, you never see before. You can see, focus inside. That's my TV, my hobby. You can see my picture.
Oh, I love
yeah.
that.
Yeah.
Superior picture. Yeah.
Excellent.
Oh, that's gorgeous.
Gorgeous.
Wonderful, wonderful depth.
Yeah.
Oh, that's great.
What is your name?
My name is Hai Tran.
Okay. Wow, this is great.
Lady Lai Flower.
Oh, yeah.
I send you flower.
Oh, yeah.
Good?
Yeah.
Yeah. Two pictures, but I'm seeing one.
Yeah. I am 64 already. I believe with photography for whole my life. And right now, I just do 3D because I like it. I don't care winter, summer, day or night. I take the picture. Everybody come. I just show people. Make the people feel better. That's why I'm happy.
I would say he's fanatic when it comes to 3Ds. Definitely fanatic because nobody spent that kind of time, attention, and money. Basically, he almost live and breathe 3Ds. Every day, there's not a day go by without taking some picture of 3Ds and mounting them and looking at them and showing to customers, showing to others.
Oh, wow. Different.
When he's excited about something, he wants to show it off. Like, he's so proud of it that he wants to share it with the world. To him, it's not showing off. It's not being, he's not bragging or anything like that. He's just so proud of it that he wants to share it with people.
Mấy ảnh chỉ chụp một cái rất dễ chụp, nhìn thấy quen khá nhiên. Nhưng mà cái quen khá nhiên ấy muốn chụp thì ai người ta nhìn một cái tấm ảnh của bố người ta cũng phải kêu wow, người ta sợ, người ta chóng mặt. Đấy mới gọi là bức ảnh sinh động. Tức là quen khá nhiên, cái độ sâu của nó hàng mấy cây số. Anh phải chụp làm sao mà anh có tiền cảnh, trung cảnh, hậu cảnh. Nhìn cứ bức ảnh ấy nó phải rước đầu. Mà anh Chiến anh cũng lại tả lại cho bố nghe, bố bảo đấy, cái người người ta nói là người ta trông rất nhiều ảnh mà người ta nhìn cái ảnh của bố mà mấy cái da của người ta hình như là nó xáo lộ đi.
He always strive to find something that is fresh, that is new. That would mean that he have to get up 4 in the morning to get that particular sunrise. Or that weird 30 degree cold because he liked that particular shot of frost in the fields. So he put a lot of effort to get that shot.
I'm amazed at some of the beautiful shots he's able to get at dawn and dusk. Because I know, like, you know, as I guess a cameraman myself, those type of shots really is, you know, about dedication in very early mornings.
Last 2 weeks in Las Vegas, I shot the night time. 2 o'clock afternoon to 3 o'clock in the morning. Yeah, the driver too tired, sleep.
Good boy, chạy đi.
Ờ, nó chạy thôi.
Chạy gần thôi. Đây à.
Good boy, very good boy. I like you, you like me. Beautiful.
Done.
Beautiful. Ah, so good.
I think that he's been doing it for so long now, and that it's something that just is very natural for him, and it's a part of who he is. Even pictures when he was back in Vietnam, like, you know, he was taking pictures back then, and he had a camera strap around his shoulder. So, I don't know, it's his life, it's him. Like, you think of photography, and you think of Daddy Tran.
Tôi nhớ lại cái thời gian ở Việt Nam, từ cái năm mà tôi lên 8 tuổi. Thì tôi ra vườn hoa, tôi thấy người ta chụp ảnh. Người ta ra chụp ảnh thì coi như là thấy cầm cái ảnh chụp xong một cái đèn nó cứ sáng lên như thế. Thế là tôi về, tôi mới bảo với gia đình là tôi muốn các cái máy ảnh như thế. Thế nhưng mà ông bố tôi, ông rất là chiều chụp ảnh salon. Đến năm 13 tuổi thì tôi cũng đã tương đối là thạo về máy ảnh rồi. Là vì tôi học về ảnh thì người ta nói các cái tấm ảnh để giữ lại kỷ niệm, không có một cái gì kỷ niệm bằng một người đã chụp thành một cái tấm ảnh cho một người khác. Thì trải qua 5, 10 năm, 20 năm, bao nhiêu năm sau, cái ảnh ấy nó vẫn là có cái hình như thế. Thì tôi thấy thế, thì tôi rất là thích từ thuở bé. Thế cho nên là cái máy ảnh hàng ngày sau mấy chục năm, không ngày nào là tôi không thắt vào cái máy ảnh. Đấy là best friend của tôi.
Oh. Maybe you can stand here. I shot you one picture. Yeah. Yeah. Beautiful smile. That's very good. Beautiful here. One, two, three. Good.
Mẹ mới có 17 tuổi thôi. Mẹ mới gặp bố ở Hà Nội. Quen thế là coi như thế là hai người coi như thế là hẹn hò xong rồi quen nhau thế là coi như là đem lòng yêu. À, bố viết thư về nhiều lắm. Xong rồi anh chị của mẹ bảo là coi như thế là ô, nó khuây gì, nó viết nhiều thư quá.
He's quite a romantic guy. I actually found a letter and it's all poetry, great and beautiful handwriting, and it's very romantic. So I see that he must have really loved her, you know?
My mother-in-law said it was interesting too because they weren't an arranged marriage, which was still common back then. So that was a bit different. And she actually said that he wrote several letters. So he must have been quite something else.
Yeah. From what I remember as a younger child in Vietnam growing up, well, life was hard. You know, mom and dad always working. Mom working at the hospital. Dad is doing some photography. He always run around this place, that place, and hardly see them. Much.
I remember 1979, China and Vietnam fighting the border. I am half Chinese, half Vietnam. And government Vietnam, they kick we out.
There's a war about to break out. So the Vietnamese government said that anybody who's Vietnamese but the root is Chinese allowed to leave the country. Our uncle persuaded mom and dad, said, why don't you come with us? We have a better life somewhere else, because there's no future here. So then mom and dad agree. I still remember, they say, we have to leave in 3 days. I still remember the word, we have to leave in 3 days. Go where, mommy? I said, we have to sell stuff and we're gonna go on a boat. And I said, okay, that's fun. Because, you know, when you're 11, you go on a journey, you know. But then they say, yeah, we probably won't be back. Winter Visuals, good afternoon. Well, just check back with us, or just check our website, vintagevisual.com. Well, this unique place is called Vintage Visuals, and this is the godfather of Vintage Visual right there. Yeah. Bố đang làm gì đấy?
Yeah, bố đang mau tình lúc thuy đi à? Còn lúc gì? Điếc phần. Wow. Yeah. That's an incredible here. That's why I like it. See? Yeah.
I met Hai about 15 years ago. We both were connected to a vintage camera store in Calgary, and he collected old cameras. And he'd come in and he'd talk, and he was always the neat, bubbly kind of person that would light up a room when he came in. He eventually got interested in that business and actually bought into it. And he's never looked back. He's one of these people that was always interested in 3D, and having a store was probably the perfect thing for him, because not only could he make a living, but he could talk to people about photography. But one day it clicked in, 3D, and that's when we got together and I started teaching him the various aspects and the equipment, and he just never looked back.
And when I got the 3D camera, I tried to test again and again.
He make the sign here, and then every night, he can pick up some flower, and then go in here. He take picture 3Ds.
All the flower here, we put some kind like this, we take picture 3D. Look beautiful here.
And all 3D yeah, picture.
All
he took.
See, that's beautiful color. Yeah.
Sometimes he take picture until 10. Doesn't want to go in. I even have to call him, you know. I say, okay, come in. You like already? You got to go sleep. He said, okay, I'm coming.
See, beautiful flower. Yeah. Beautiful flower. If I shut up here, you can zoom my go, you see the lights. Beautiful. But right now, I have 6 2D camera, and sometimes I build 200 baht together.
For me, the attraction of 3D is I really feel like I'm there sometimes. You don't get that when you're using a little tiny image or even an image on the computer. You don't really feel you're there. But when you have a 3D viewer and you immerse yourself into that scene, you really do feel like you're there. I like to record things how I see them. And most people see the world in two eyes, but they take with one eye, which is a shame because we see the world in 3D. To me, the photography should be in 3D as well.
So when we left Vietnam there, we head on a boat to go to Hong Kong. And I think the capacity is only probably half of that, 150, but they somehow squeeze double that little boat.
Thì lúc đó thì bố mang 3 cái máy ảnh đi và một vali ảnh kỷ niệm. Mấy những ảnh bố thích thì là bố mang đi.
Một tháng ở trên tàu mà coi như ở dưới thuyền út trà.
On the way, the stress on the boat is so heavy, the bottom of the boat burst. So water starts leaking, so remember there was panic.
My family in the sea, almost died. The boat very problem. The water come very lousy. And lucky we see the fishing boat, Hong Kong fishing boat. And they come, they deal. They said everybody have gold, diamond, have money, keep them. And they can help you. And my family, only picture. Have picture, they don't need the picture. And they just need something value. And I have to keep them the camera. One camera, I keep 2, and save for my family. And they hook the boat, they pull to Hong Kong area.
They told us in Hong Kong, they take us to a camp, a refugee camp.
Hong Kong coi như thế là 8 tháng. Nhưng mà lại nó nhộm nhạm như thế, có trẻ con mà ở bên ấy không ở được. Nhưng mà nếu mà ở Hồng Kông như thế nó nguy hiểm, và sau này có khi là chúng nó coi như khổ nữa, còn khổ hơn ở Việt Nam cơ. Bây giờ ở đấy khổ quá rồi, coi như là người nào cũng được giấy mà đi trước thì là sướng rồi.
Purpose of being in this camp is to wait for people to sponsor us. And our family initially wanted to go to France, but not too many people sponsor from there, so we wait quite a long time. So then one of our uncle decided to, well, let's just go to Canada. That's the last place we want to go because it's too cold.
Vào cái vùng đó là vùng Bắc Cực, tức là lúc nào cũng có tuyết, lạnh lắm. Nhưng mà chả biết đi đâu mà bây giờ.
So then, there's some people from Calgary sponsor, so they offer that to us, and so we say, okay, we go.
Thế bảo mình đi như này là chẳng qua vì con thôi, để cho nó có cuộc sống nó sướng, yeah.
Sometimes very cold, but I don't thinking about cold at all. I want to do a good job, hobby for me. That's why I'm happy.
He's put a lots of effort to get the shot that he wants. No matter how difficult or how long it takes, if he likes that scene, he will just pursue it. Sometimes I'm worried because some of the shot it can be dangerous. And just hope that he pay attention or slip right down, you know.
The roof here. See, the roof here is so dangerous. That's why I don't care the roof here. Even sometimes fell up. See?
Very dangerous. They're gonna fall down anytime. That's why nobody go in here. But he, he is the number one. He love his photo. That's why.
The last time we went here, we no see the sign, and we park here.
Mẹ ngồi đấy, cho đo bố đi chụp ảnh. Được khoảng 10 phút sau, thì hai cái con bè, một con to lắm. Nó phải đến 700 pound hay bao nhiêu, nó to lắm. Thế này có một cái con baby nữa, nó ngồi bên cạnh này. Thế mẹ rất thích cái con, hiểu chưa? Nhìn nó hay ghê lắm. Thế này coi như hai con ở đây này.
Hai con này đứng ngay ngồi table này. Five meter.
Cứ đứng nhìn nó chứ. Không nhớ ra nó là cái con hung dữ. Nhìn nó đến 3-4 phút sau mới nhớ ra. Ô, thôi chết rồi, nó là con bé. Thế là cuối cùng nó là coi như là bảo bây giờ, what do we do now? Thế là coi bảo, đừng chạy, đừng chạy. Đừng chạy đây, đi đường này. Cứ thế này này, thế đi ngược này, xong đi vòng ở đây. Xong bố lại đi trở lại 2 bước. Mới đi được có 3 bước hay gì đấy. Thế lại. Bố quáp cái máy ảnh này. Thế là coi như bố cứ thế này.
Quáp the camera like this. Quáp the camera like this. I said, no, go, go. Don't run, don't run. Don't run, exactly. Same, I said today. I said, Hương, don't run.
If we see the bear this time, maybe I got you shot the picture, you know. I got to shot one picture and see. Sợ lắm. Đi đi Hải. Thôi đi đừng chụp nữa, nó đến nhanh lắm. Đi.
Chờ tôi tích tắc xong.
Nhưng mà nó đến nhanh lắm. Đi đi.
Hả? Đang.
Đi đi. Đi đi. Đi đi. Nặng lắm, không có người nào dám đến đâu.
Cô đi rồi.
Hả? Đi đi. Về sau rồi về. Về nhà rồi bắt đầu mới sợ cơ. Thế này cả đêm không ngủ nghĩ con bé. Thế cái gì? Thế là crazy.
Well, we came to Canada in February 1980, and at the time I was 12 years old. And John, my younger brother, was 8, and Anne was 3 years old.
Nó lạnh lắm rồi tuyết nó đến đầu gối. Thế là coi như người ta bảo lãnh cho người ta thuê nhà cho ở ở cái chỗ sau người ta xin việc cho đi làm.
My mom worked two jobs. She worked at A&W and then she worked at Zellers. At that time she didn't know English. She had an opportunity to become a nurse's aide, but she got pregnant right when she came to Canada with Eileen and they wouldn't offer her a job. So then, of course, what do you take? You take anything you can, so it winds up fast food. My mom was quite sad, I must admit, in the beginning, because she really didn't have any friends. Like, all she did was throw herself into work. Like, she worked so much day and night, and then it's hard, too, because she had a newborn baby.
I remember our sponsor take Dad to look for work. So he asked, what kind of work would you like to do? Like, what can you do? So Dad said, I'm a photographer, and I like taking pictures. They take him to this photo lab, and he got a job right away. I think at like $4.25 or something like that. So that was his first job.
I knew we weren't well off. My mom and dad were never around. All I remember was Tim always taking care of us. Tim practically was the mother and father at that time.
Bố đi làm ban ngày, mẹ đi làm ban đêm, làm hay ăn đắp dịu ấy. Thế là Tim với lại John ở nhà take care nó.
Dad started to explore the city at the time. Every weekend, he just disappeared. He would just take the bus, you know, go here, go there, different shops. And that's when he discovered all these camera shops and these pawn shops, you know, antique stores and things like that.
Nhưng mà những ngày nghỉ, thứ bảy, chủ nhật tôi nghỉ, thì tôi đến các cái cửa hàng tôi mua máy ảnh. Thì mua máy ảnh, tôi không có tiền thì tôi nợ lại người ta. Người ta bỏ vào trong cái account ấy.
Một tháng hai cái thì một cái là mua đồ ăn, mua gạo về nhà, và một cái là coi là he xây cái tiền này he đi các cái pawn shop, he buy máy ảnh, cứ thế này he tập trung vào, he là có nhiều xong rồi mang về.
Mom don't understand why we so poor, we strapped just get by, but Dad just go and buy these cameras and lenses. She didn't understand that, so they often would have fight over monies, over his spending habits, and so on.
Bố mua bố giấu chứ. Yeah, bố giấu, giấu xuống cái cầu thang, gầm cầu thang ở dưới bấy xì bàn, không biết được. Yeah. Là vì bố không muốn cho biết là coi như bố xì ven cái tiền ấy để đi mua mai.
Sau đó bố biêu một cái sale thật to, trong vào khoảng 7 năm rồi, thì bố có tầm vào khoảng độ hơn 200 cái máy ảnh.
Bố thích là bố phải mua, không ai có thể gàn được, không có ai có thể là bảo không, không mua. Bố thích là bố phải mua.
He wouldn't listen, so he just continued. And then later on, he was thinking that eventually maybe have a business, you know, reselling these items. Vintage Visual is a very unique store because we're the only last surviving film store here. Because everybody is gone digital, but we have integrity to film. That's why we will die with film.
Cái chính phải nói thật với các con là coi như thế là nhờ anh Thiêm, bố mẹ dựa vào anh. Chứ còn ngoài ra không có thể bố mẹ tự động đứng lên và mở cửa hàng được. Phải nói thật với các con như thế. Tất cả mọi việc, tức là deal với khách hàng, rồi là deal với tất cả mọi người ở trên cái website, cái bố mẹ có biết gì đâu.
The store really doing well because of my dad, you know, bringing all these good stocks in. Because he go around to get these cameras and lenses, and was very well known around the city, and even Canada here, people from all over Canada and even around the world know about Vintage Visual. So in that sense, I think it's a success because our name is out there. You know, a lot of people know us, and we're the largest selection of used camera in North America.
2 years ago, the digital came out. Tại vì tôi Vintage Visual câu đáo baby 50%. But I got good setup, good service, lọt chỉ tô để đóng sao tờ thép lấy tiết bật viên tiệt ví dụ vì chỉ tiêu kíp symbol vi thép camera chỉ tô in thao hia để xem o là cắt xăm mờ chủ viên tiệt ví dụ đã thoại uy bí gì đã thoại uy đu chỉ tiêu ok.
Bố nghĩ cũng khó lòng mà bố retire được là vì cái đời của bố là suốt ngày làm. Mà nếu mà bố retire bố không biết làm cái gì. Cho nên là bố phải keep cái cửa hàng Vintage Visual run. Đấy, bố phải build up, keep nó very strong, nó run. Nếu mà nó run tốt thì thỉnh thoảng bố có cái chỗ đi đi lại lại mà see customer, people để bố xấu thuy đi.
Oh, no way.
Nào, come here. Sit in here. Bring all your stuff. I like to take picture of the background building here.
Okay.
Can you sit in the chair?
Okay, okay, all right.
You call your friend here.
Right here? Yeah. Sit right here?
Cái tính của bố là nói thẳng, bố không để bụng một cái gì hết. Nếu mà anh wrong, tôi nói.
He's a difficult man sometimes, like he's a good man, but when he doesn't get his way, sometimes he gets a little much.
Tính của bố thì coi như là rất là nóng, nhưng mà rất là thẳng. Ví dụ người ta đến, người ta mua hàng, người ta mặc cả, người ta này khác. Thế là người ta, tại cái người ta mặc cả nhiều quá rồi bố. Tức là coi như là mày rất là kỳ bo, cũng nhiều khi mất khách như thế nữa. Cho nên mẹ cũng không muốn bố ở đây nhiều. Mẹ muốn là coi như là bố cứ đi lang thang, đi chơi đâu đi rồi, đi chụp ảnh.
Time I was baby, he would take me out and take picture of me. Well, that's why I'm sick of it. That's why I don't want to follow his path. Too many pictures.
I remember me as being his, you know, little assistant, where I would carry his camera for him. And I remember him taking pictures of people around these lakes in Vietnam. That's one of the ways, I guess, he made money and has how he taught me. And while he's taking their picture, I guess the day is slow, he would take pictures of me as well.
Because he liked photography, of course the girls were more into it. We liked to dress up, makeup, sure, why not? We got to wear it. Usually parents don't allow kids until how old to wear makeup. My dad allowed it. He would help put it on and dress us up. When my sister was born, I was carrying her, and then that's when it started. And then he just took every weekend.
You know what was fun is that we did have lots of dresses. There's lots of nice dresses that we did put on. And, you know, like he let us take pictures with lots of props. There was like a hat or like, you know, some accessories or dolls. There's one doll that was in lots of the pictures. There was a time where I was exactly the same height as this doll. And the doll would always stand in one corner of the house. And I dressed up in the doll's clothes. And I stood there. And I remember my dad coming around the corner and I scared the hell out of him.
Eileen, bố dùng Mai Anh là model. Thế bố chụp ảnh, bố đem lên xưởng rửa. Thì ai người ta cũng thích ảnh là vì Eileen với Mai Anh rất là khiếu. Thế là thử ra là lúc đó bố lại càng phấn khởi nữa.
Something I really remember is being dressed up as a native. When I was younger, I didn't really think anything of it. And I remember he too used to split my hair down the middle and then try to make me look more native than what I was. But I thought it was kind of cute. I thought it was fun, like Halloween or something. And that's one. But then, you know, like models with a big burly hat and fur coat that matched. Like, what little girl doesn't like that? But when you get older, it's just too much.
There's times where you wanted to go outside. Like, I remember I just wanted to go outside and play. Like, we always wanted to do other things. And he'd be like, no, you have to go take pictures. It wasn't just like, I'm just going to take one picture of you. It was multiple pictures.
Oh, I was a slave to it, really. I had to do so much photography every weekend. It was a hobby for him, but he thought we enjoyed it too. And he always bribed us with food, and he thought that's the way that would make us happy. So he would take us around, and it was torturous, really.
it's really hard to say no. It's your father, and this is what he does, and this is his passion. And we're his family, and we're going to help him out if he wants to take as many pictures, or even though you may not enjoy it all the time.
When I talk about him, the word that always comes up, or the phrase, is one of a kind.
I've also noticed he likes lots, lots of everything. So if he decides to get stuff for the house, it's never just one or two. It's got to be the whole thing.
When I first saw the house, I thought it was quite eccentric. And I wouldn't say scared, but caught off guard. You know, there's barbed wire and I don't know how many locks.
He had a phobia of people taking things. It even escalated more when we got robbed. That caused something, I think, very traumatic that happened to him.
Oh, my keychain is huge. I have keys for everything. There's one key when you're going through the front gate. There's one key in the storm door. There's one key getting into the main door, and there's one on the top lock as well. So there's four keys to get inside. In the back, there's a separate key for the back doors. There's also a storm door at the back that has a different key, which I do not have, so I cannot get in that way. Multiple locks on the gates around the sides of the house. We've got locks inside as well. So we've got locks on the bedroom doors. Each one upstairs is always locked.
That's another thing I've never seen before, is so many locks in a house. And I've never actually seen people have double-sided locks where you can't open it from the inside. So I always joke around with Anne that if there's ever a fire, then, you know, you guys are pretty much toast.
My dad's not easy to live with. His way was not logical to us. We think differently than him.
Everything that he has, I feel, usually is more important than what you have to do. And that's what the way that he asked you to do something or whatever. And, you know, it's just, it's a time period. I think he's just, you know, he's old school. My mom is the person that you'd always go to. We've always gone through mom. It's just like, let me talk to him or whatever it is, or you have to wait till he calms down about something, because he doesn't really understand. So my mom will talk to him for us. And my mom is definitely more approachable. My dad is hard to get close to sometimes. So it's really hard to open up with him. I do remember certain times where he had a very, very strong temper, and I was scared of him a lot of the times.
My dad definitely do have a temper. When it does happen, it's like you don't want to be around because, you know, it's very illogical, and it's very difficult, you know, growing up in that environment. But a lot of people won't understand how this happy, jolly man could sometimes be so, I guess, harsh.
Well, I must admit, my relationship with my dad has not always been a good one growing up. And I can understand why, too. Distress, like, we were very poor. They both had to work very hard.
Now I look at his point of view. He had a lot on his plate. He had to raise us, clothe us, and I think he wanted more in life than just what he had at that time until he had more opportunity, as in when he got offered the store, when they saved enough for a house, you know. It took time, but they were quite patient and they did that.
They are our house.
Our house?
Yeah.
And then we sit down in the back, John, right? Yeah. That's an art of allow here. It's all so that hard working. He is work day and night, whatever he have time. This year, purple flower, he go and then he look up and water every day.
Everything here?
Yeah.
Remote control.
Yeah.
See, the
and
light on, off here.
And
on, up, on.
Yes.
That's a hobby. The hobby garden.
He'd like to talk about his house and what his latest purchase. He always talking about material things, prosperity, and so on. I guess it's his nature to brag. brag about his accomplishment.
And the time I come to Canada, I just have two cameras. But now I have how many cameras? Right now I have 40,000 cameras. Many, many, I cannot count.
Where that bragging comes from is because maybe when he was younger, he didn't have much. And now that, you know, he's done this, he's accomplished, you know, opening the store, you know, being able to, you know, pursue his 3D love. So he wants to show it to people.
You're gonna do it.
it's very abrupt too. Like we're walking somewhere, all of a sudden we see some, hey guy, and then shows him all these pictures. But that's how he shows his proudness. And to have all this like healthy family, accomplished a lot, and that's why he deserved to do it. I might say that embarrassing stuff, but go ahead, he deserves it.
Every day, same row, same time. And we open the store, we set up 9:30. Sometime, lot of customers were outside already. The store, very famous. Everybody like it.
I remember I was working, filming in New York. And he called me and left me a message on the cell saying that, you know, John, call me back. He didn't say anything else at all. Like, I thought, whoa, something's weird here. So I went and called him back and I asked him, like, what's going on? And then he told me, he says, you know, the store has to close.
One day, this guy came in and we thought his customers, you know, my dad was showing him 3Ds. And all of a sudden, he said, I'm the new owner of this building. I'm going to take over and that you should plan to move. I'm just telling you 3 months ahead. From then on, things just went, I guess, crazy.
Well, I feel no good for every day I thinking about customer. Because customer, same fan, every day see, every day, every week, they shop in Shito. Right now, we meet them, we feel sorry. Because you got no joy.
Khi mà nó báo cho cái tin mà coi như là nó mua cái building ở đây này, thì là bố mẹ đã no rồi, đã no rồi, không biết là coi như bây giờ làm thế nào. Bố mẹ cũng đã đi tìm cái nhà để thuê, nhưng mà nó đắt lắm.
She sad, yeah, she no happy. Every day I talk with my wife. The time is the time. We cannot keep the time forever.
Another big reason why I think it closed is because my dad, you know, is tired and he didn't want to shift into, you know, selling new equipment, meaning like digital equipment.
So he has to slow it down because the store can't survive on manual cameras all the time because people want digital now. So he knows that because of them closing down, forcing him to close, it's sometimes meant to be.
How many stores are there around like this? I haven't really seen it, not to this extent. You know, there's camera stores that sell used gear, but not all used gear or vintage gear. So it's very unfortunate. You'll be able to buy online with vintage visuals, but it's not really the same thing because I like to come and hold it and check the glass and everything. Yeah, so it's very unfortunate.
When people come in, he have opportunity to show, you know, his work. And every time he show people his 3Ds, he's just ecstatic, you know, he's very happy. Especially people who say, oh, fantastic shot, you know, this is great. How you do this, you know? So that's gonna be a little bit tougher for him to show his work.
Shutting down that platform, that group environment, I think is gonna be difficult. You know, he still has his friends, but like everything, when you don't have that central meeting place, I think he'll slow a little bit.
The store, to me, say my best friend, say my family. We got a lot of friends here, but right now, we're moving. We meet them, they meet we. That's why we got a little bit feel terrible. That's the vintage visual, empty. Empty right now.
I could sense that it is sad for him to close down the store because he built so many years and so hard, you know, to become the way it was.
I will admit a lot of camera, so many camera around here, my friend. And every day I touch, I show customer, I learn more. But right now, the store closed, and we meet the store beautiful like that.
It was a pleasure meeting you.
Okay.
It truly was.
Okay, thank you. All right. A lot of people, they come to the store, they said, I want to see you guys more than I buy. But we don't have a shop anymore. That's why. And all the time, they said, good luck. They talk about for like that. And they see you, but see you where? Yeah. Okay, thank you very much. Yeah, we met you. Yeah, we met you, guy. Thank you. Yeah, bye-bye. Yeah, the sign, I think I put it in here forever, but right now I have to put down.
He is, of course, sad about the store closing, but it was time. I think he realizes that too.
He even told me, he says that, you know, he's content about stop trying to make money anymore because, you know, he's worked out hard and worked out long and, you know, he's content of, you know, just being relaxed at home, you know, going out shooting his 3D, being relaxed with the families.
Everything worked out well and now he's still healthy enough to travel, which he'll do, and with my mom, so then they can relax and it's time for them to take a break, for sure.
Right now in basement, we put a lot of good stuff stock here because the store we have to move in.
Vintage Visual still survive, but it's online. I think it will be working out good. At first he was stressed. I could see that he don't know how this gonna go. But last couple of days it been better. Because every single day, yeah, we have some order every single day so far of the week. So that make him happy because he think, oh, maybe this could work, you know.
Từ ngày đóng cửa đến giờ là coi như là bố không phải suy nghĩ nữa. Bố chỉ muốn là đi để cho nó kiểu thời gian đi. Thế là bố nhà bố không biết làm gì cả. À, hồi xưa bố thích nhất là đi như thế để bố mua máy ảnh cho bố tính. Mua cái này là kiếm được bao nhiêu tiền, mua cái kia là kiếm được bao nhiêu tiền, là bố hạ bì nhất. Bây giờ thì bố chỉ thích đi chụp ảnh. Nếu mà được nhiều ảnh, ngày hôm ấy chụp được 1-2 cuộn là bố sướng là về nè.
I'm glad that he has this hobby and I'm glad he has a new passion for photography. You know, like this is his time now. He doesn't have a store anymore, but you know, he can go off and he can take his 3D pictures and maybe that's good. Mom and dad can just go off and then go on these trips and travel and just enjoy life now.
Anh không biết về 3D. Tự nhiên anh chết đi 1/3 cuộc đời.
He's more mellower, I don't see the temper anymore, and every single time I come back, I hear how better it is and how it's way easier to get along with. So I'm very happy about that.
Wakey, wakey. Ethan, hi buddy.
Giving him grandchild just means the legacy is going to be carried on, I guess. And I think he hopes that maybe he might be interested in maybe photography or something artistic. That'd be cute. Grandpa and the little guy go take pictures together. You know, never know. He could have the knack for it too, just like his grandpa.
Wow.
Hey,
everybody that gets involved in 3D has some sort of legacy. Anything in 3D is going to have a big impact on the future. For example, you can see pictures of Hai's relatives at a wedding, and we can pass that on to the children, that they can remember their grandfather and their mother and their father in 3D. It's not just your artistic part of it, but the history that you can pass on in 3D. Yeah.
He's such a larger-than-life personality that even to think that one day he might not be here, because it's so hard to ever duplicate him. He is one of a kind, certainly.
Bố không phải là bố nhớ cho người ta là bố là cái ông ghê gớm gì cả, mà bố chỉ có nhớ là bố chỉ để lại những cái tấm hình, người ta biết là cái tấm hình này ai chụp là cái ông Hải chụp, cái bác Hải chụp. Bởi vì ông này ông là cả cuộc đời của ông ấy theo đuổi vẽ ảnh. Đấy, này bố muốn như thế là bố happy.